NACDL is the Association of the Nation's Criminal Defense Bar.
Taking on tear gas as we were. What is it that made you want to stand there in front of, you know, these protesters and between them and police and tell them to calm down? What is it that made you come out here?
You can't lose any more lives, man. I'm a public defender. I can't represent any more people. We don't need more people to go to die. No more people being arrested. We need to take a stand and do it the right way.
Jail 40 times during the 60s. And it was lawyers, unbelievable, courageous men and women of the bar that came to my rescue. They defended us. They filed briefs. They stood before judges in small towns, in the cities, in rural areas of the American South. And if it hadn't been for the lawyers during that period, I don't know where we will be as a nation and as a people. So I want to thank you, this wonderful organization. I want to thank you, Public Defender Training Center, for getting in the way, for defending those that have been left out and left behind. Thank you. Thank you for not giving up. Thank you for not giving in. Thank you for keeping the faith. Thank you for keeping your eyes on the prize. Thanking you for helping the least, the ordinary people in our society. I truly believe that during this period, during this time, when we hear people putting people down because of their race, their color, their nationality, their language, or sexual orientation, or whatever, you have to speak up. You have to speak out. You have to defend people. So I say, hang in there, keep the faith, and keep your eyes on the prize. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Incredibly powerful words by John Lewis, right? But we have failed. Everyone in this room, myself included, we have failed. Bail is one of the most important moments in the criminal justice system. The first question that we hear from our clients when we meet them is what? When am I getting out? And I want to acknowledge something as I stand here. Look at me. I'm a middle-aged woman of privilege, a white woman. And I walk into courtrooms every day. I do not get a pass because I've been a public defender. I do not get a pass because I hear stories of my clients who are in poverty. I have to acknowledge my privilege, and like Song taught us and what Jeff taught us, I have to know what my biases are. I have to understand them. I've got to acknowledge them. And one of the things as a woman of privilege that I have now sought to do is that every time I walk into a courtroom, I have to understand how our system is enslaving people, how we are decimating communities and committing, and I want to find words for it. Is it genocide of communities? Is it slavery? What are the words? but I want you to look into your courtrooms when you walk in. We are caging, as Alex Karakastanis says, we are caging our community. This is from Tejas from Connecticut. We walk into courtrooms, and I was in court on Monday. And I walk into a courtroom in Denver, Colorado. And I see the bar enclosure. And on the left-hand side are the public defenders, the criminal defense lawyers, my brethren, all white. And I look over to the right side of the courtroom, and there is the prosecutors, a young white woman and a middle-aged white man. And what are they talking about? Is it about bail release? It's about the Broncos. And then I look to the left, and behind glass in the courtroom are 35 men and women wearing bright yellow jumpsuits. The men in yellow, the women with yellow and white stripes, mostly black and brown. Look at what is happening in our courtrooms, and then we wonder why. Mass incarceration. We all remember Ferguson and the day that we woke up to the news that Michael Brown was murdered. And if the sound of his mother's voice as she looked at her son who was dead and they wouldn't let her go to for 4 hours. And we talked about police brutality and the shooting of unarmed black men, women, and children. We talked about all of the horrific things that were happening. But what was going on this on the bottom of that? We have police brutality and shootings here, but what did we find out when the Department of Justice issued the Ferguson report? What did we hear from Thomas Harvey, who started Arch City Defenders in St. Louis County? We found out about what was going on in St. Louis. We found out that on average, 2 warrants per person per year for things that were so minor as traffic infractions, failure to pay parking fines, fees, fines, and costs. So what is it like to live in Ferguson? You're afraid to get into your car in the morning to go to work or to pick up your children in school because if you see a blue, you're going to be pulled over. You will be arrested, oftentimes in front of your children. And then you're thrown into a horrific, barbaric cell where they're 4 bunking. You've got the bunk beds with 2 people and 2 people on the ground, 1 person next to the toilet that is overflowing, the walls that have not been cleaned, the blood, the mucus, the urine, the vomit, the women with no hygiene products that are menstruating. This is the reality of what was happening in Ferguson. And that's the, we have the micro and the macro aggressions of what is happening in our country, but these are people that are held on minor infractions. It's happening every single day. And why? We know the purpose of bail is to, you know, FTA, are you going to show up? Are you going to protect the public? This is to guard against punishment prior to adjudication. The presumption of innocence is supposed to exist in our country. These are beautiful cases, Stack versus Boyle, Salerno, and I have to say, it wasn't until, and I, you know, I think I always made very good bail arguments. I was trained by some of the greatest leaders in the country, Bill Leahy in Massachusetts, Bob Berukowitz in Seattle, Washington. I would stand before judges, I would make strong, cogent arguments, but I didn't really understand the power of that first appearance. And when I took the job at NACDL, I started to reread all of these laws. I stand in federal court every day. Why is it that so many people are being detained? And I said to Norm Reamer, one of the most powerful moments at NACDL is when we were in a very, very high-level meeting in a very fancy big house in D.C. And it was all public defender leaders talking about pretrial detention and the crisis in America. And one of the highest leaders in the Obama administration said, you know what, I'm hearing your stories. You know, we should follow the federal system. And Norman Reamer, if you know Mr. Reamer, he will be, he's kind of stealth, and he just kind of leaned in and he said, that would be a huge mistake. Because in some of the districts, the detention rates are 87%. And he schooled this very high-level administrative person in, that will remain nameless, and she said, well, please, can you send me more data on this? And Norm immediately went back to the NACTL offices, prepared a package, and then met again with her and a few other people privately, smaller, to school about what's going on state and federally. And the Obama administration said, we will commit and dedicate our resources to reforming pretrial release in the state and federal prison. So when my CJA lawyers and my federal defenders, we have to stand when we are for our first appearance, stop detaining everyone. We have a code that says there's a presumption of personal recognizance unless the person will, the language is beautiful. If you could say that there are conditions of release for our clients that are in federal detention. And I quoted to a Republican nominee last week in federal court, the Salerno decision, which says you can pretrial detain. But what Rehnquist said, and I said, Justice Rehnquist said, in our society, liberty is the norm and detention prior to trial or without trial is the carefully limited exception. Free our clients pre-trial. And I say that with, oh, I did this, I'm so great. I had an hour and a half detention hearing. I make this argument. I kind of guilt the judge about Salerno. Judge says, I will release your client on GPS tracking and a $500 cash bail. Client is sitting in the dock and he goes like this to me. I think feeling good, pretty good about myself. And then I walk out and the pretrial service officer is speaking to my client's mother and his auntie, who he was living with her five children, ages 2 through 12, who were in the courthouse, outside the courtroom. We have a problem, says pretrial services. Auntie is on Section 8 housing. We don't know if we can GPS your client. Mom says to me, I don't know if we can make the $500 cash bail. We'll have to sell some stuff. So I'm sitting here to tell you that I'm talking about this nationally, and I up myself. And so we have to be cognizant, what does $500 mean to our clients? And I'm sorry, I should be at a two, but I'm pissed. $500, right? You know, the difference between Sandra Bland and Bill Cosby, he can write $1 million check. Sandra Bland died. $500. It took 10 days for my client's family to raise $500. So every time you hear those words, $500, think about what it means. Bail schedules are unconstitutional. It's unconstitutional. And if you hear an explosion someday, it's one of two things. It's either Jeff Robinson with like goggles on and taking down Stone Mountain, or it's me in a courtroom when a judge says the word schedule, because my head wants to explode. It is unconstitutional. I want to introduce you to Mr. Walker, another wonderful litigation. But this is a case that in Walker versus the city of Calhoun. 54 years old, schizophrenic, goes off his meds, is walking down the street, and is under the influence of alcohol. He's arrested for drunk pedestrian walking, or some kind of weird Georgia law. He's held on $160 cash bail for walking down the street under the influence of alcohol. Do you think that's a serious offense? For 6 days, he was held on $160 of bail. He decompensated. He didn't get, shockingly, do you think our clients get their meds? Do you think that they're evaluated when they're picked up for drunk and disorderly or walking? I don't even know if he was disorderly, he was just drunk. So the Department of Justice under the Obama administration started to look at these issues of pretrial detention. And they were writing statements of interest and amicus briefing. And they were saying, if we have all this on the NACDL website, I beseech you, just download this stuff and bring it to court. The DOJ says it's a position of the United States that any bail or bond scheme that mandates payment of prefixed amounts for different offenses in order to gain pretrial release without any regard for indigence not only violates the 14th Amendment's Equal Protection Clause, but also constitutes bad public policy. It is long established that the American criminal justice system should not work differently for the indigent and the wealthy. We have got to be citing these cases when the court is putting these ridiculous cash bails on our poor clients. The materials I've given you are the New Jersey and the Colorado bail books, where NACDL has worked with the public defender system, the ACLU, in collaboration to write a manual for the defense of what you can be doing every single time you walk into a court of law and are arguing at first appearance. And it's a strong first interview, and I use the words of Cynthia Roseberry, who taught me many years ago that when you're meeting with your clients, you must rock with your clients. Spend the time in that first interview to look at your clients. Kiana's thing with the ears, and to listen, and Martine, listen. We do it in voir dire. Let's do it with our clients in our initial interview. We have in the appendix of the materials, what are some of the questions that we should be asking our clients about their roots to the community, their mental health issues, their family, their education, all their employment, their military service. We're repping so many returning veterans. And when I say about mental health issues, it's critically important that you talk about that, because they will not get their medication. And there's no reason for a 54-year-old schizophrenic young man that was, not young, I think 54 is young now, sorry, middle-aged, to be held or caged while awaiting trial on a minor infraction. Risk assessments, that's a whole CLE, right? And I couldn't agree with Brandon Moore. I mean, NACDL is commissioning, we're gonna have, and again, I'm gonna be like Rick Jones, like join NACDL. We are gonna be studying risk assessments. Do they have a disparate impact on our clients of color? And because in Colorado, we have a risk assessment, it's called the CPAT. One of the questions is, age at first arrest. Do you think that may have an impact on our poor black community? Do you think that sometimes when I'm standing in court and my client scores high because he was arrested at the age of 14 for minor in possession of marijuana, where if you look across town, whites smoke as much dope as blacks. We heard that yesterday, right? And so why is it that my 14-year-old white clients don't get arrested, but my 14-year-old black clients do? So when they score high or moderate to high risk, it is my duty to say to the court, this is why my clients scored this way. And the risk assessment tool is only one little tool that we have in our box. I want to tell you about my client and what his story is. So we're studying risk assessments, but we have to understand it. Understand your state statutes. They're oftentimes fabulous, and they're often presumption of release and recognizance. Read the ABA 10 principles, understand this. New Jersey, which has been very successful initially in reforming the law, they've got a long way to go, but their new statute said it's to be liberally construed to effectuate the purpose of primarily relying upon pretrial release by non-monetary means to achieve the three purposes of pretrial: ensuring their appearance in court, protecting safety of the persons and the community, and preventing defendants from obstructing or attempting to obstruct, blah, 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 justice, right? Pretrial release. In the state of New Jersey since January 1st, 2017, guess how many cash bails there have been? Eight, right, good, you've been listening. And a lot of that has to do with the amazing work of Alex Shalom from the New Jersey ACLU, Joe Krakor, the head of the New Jersey State Public Defenders, and Jennifer Saletti, the training director. And Alex Shalom, before it even went into effect in January, said, if they don't abide by it, I am ready to start suing. And so he was ready, and when they didn't abide by it, they start filing. And the other thing about New Jersey is they had all of the stakeholders. The judges were trained for 2 years before the law went into effect. They understood what risk assessment was. They understood the power of cash bail. The prosecutors were trained, but most importantly, the defenders were trained. And when those defenders go into court every day, they're making a beautiful record. State and constitutions are wonderful. Again, I grew up in New Jersey. I practice in Massachusetts. I practice in Washington State. I'm now in Colorado. Our state constitutions are more proactive for defendants' rights. And I guarantee that in most of their states, you've got beautiful state constitutions that are guaranteeing the right to be free. In Massachusetts, knowing your state case law, and I'm going to go old school for a second, because in August of 2017, there's wonderful case law in Massachusetts. And they went back to 1641. That's what they do in Massachusetts. No man's person shall be restrained or imprisoned by any authority whatsoever before the law hath sentenced him thereto, if he can put into sufficient security, i.e., bail, B-A-Y-L-E, or a man prize for his appearance and good behavior in the meantime, with an E, unless, you know, you're reading this, you must allow people to be free. And that case had to do with someone that was held for 3 years, pretrial, because he couldn't afford bail, and the judge refused to take into consideration the issue of indigency. So just go 1600, right? You know, Kiana wants to be the queen of voir dire. I want to be the queen of pretrial release, and everyone wants to be, you know, we have got to go into court and start looking at this stuff that is freeing our clients. You have to take on dog, right? We took dog on in Colorado. Dog is showing up in New Jersey all the time. Damn it, dog. Doggy, go home, right? It's like what Alex Shalom is saying, I will take on anyone, including the dog, the bounty hunter. And I say that kind of with a joke, but it's not a joke. You know, the bonds industry in this country is so incredibly powerful. You know, the story that Brandon told, I mean, that is devastating, and you hear over and over and over about people that pay bondsmen, and they're chained to them for the rest of their lives when their cases are dismissed. And that is devastation. So we have to be strong and proud and take on the bail bonds industry and tell the judges that this is wrong. We can't be doing this. Brandon told you about the right to have counsel at first appearance. If it's not happening, you should really be fighting for it. We know the numbers. 2.5 times more likely to be released on PR if there's a lawyer. Money bonds that were set are 2.5 times more likely to make that bond. If you're going to set bond, it's something that the client can make. And you get lower sentences. You don't risk your losing your jobs, your licenses, their immigration consequences, the collateral consequences of being held for 2, 3, 4 days. If I had not taken this job at NACDL, I would not have read the statistics of what happens to low-risk defendants that spend even 2 days in jail and the number of the recidivism rates. So understanding all this stuff is so critically important. And I don't curse anymore when I speak publicly, and I'm sorry, Norm, for the slide. But we need to slow the system down. And Ben Bradley used that word from the Washington Post and said sometimes that's the most powerful word, and this is the powerful word. We need to slow the system down. So when I'm in court and there's 35 people behind that glass and I get my chance at the podium, I'm going to, and even when the judge is going like this, I don't care. I don't hear this. I'm going to slow it down. When the judge says the word schedule, I say things, and as Jeff Robinson taught me when I was working with him, to shift my voice. My thought bubble might be, you big, blah, 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 about the judge. But what I say is, as the court is well aware, the law in Colorado changed in 2013, and schedules have been deemed to be unconstitutional. There's a presumption of recognizance, and the pretrial services, they've already done a risk assessment. My client came out as lowest risk. And so I ask you to adopt it, and then you talk about your client. So you use a softer voice, but you're basically like to the judge, and you're getting it down. Last, we make a difference. Oh, I'm not going to go there. I want to end with this. As someone with white privilege, there's two things that keep resonating or I think about, and I've heard this phrase. Take space, make space. And I think it's our job as white privileged lawyers who are here to take space. when we are at the dinner and Thanksgiving and we hear inappropriate, discriminatory, racist comments by family members, we stand in our privilege and we educate. Silence is violence if we don't. We take space when we're standing in line at the Starbucks, or as it happened to me in a small airport in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and you educate when you hear people saying things that are ignorant or racist or discriminatory. But we must make space when our friends, our clients, our colleagues of color are sharing their stories of what it means to be personally discriminated against, to listen, to learn and absorb. I can say that the lawyers in this room who are my heroes and my sheroes, who are black and brown and who have been discriminated on a daily basis and sometimes shockingly and when they're speaking at conferences, we have to listen and make the space for our colleagues, because we will learn from our colleagues about what it is to be black or brown in this country. And I hope that when we walk into a courtroom and we meet our clients for the first time, we start to listen more carefully to their stories. When we stand in front of a judge, we will stand in our power. As Kiana said, you know, we do our power pose and we stand there and we don't flinch. And we advocate for our clients to be released into the community pre-trial. This is one of the most critical issues in our criminal legal system. Jeff Sessions is not in my courtroom. And so we can be devastated about what's happening in this country, but we are talking to the judges every day in state court, in federal court, on an individual basis, and we have to continue to fight now more than ever. We don't have the DOJ access to justice and the DOJ that's, you know, and the criminal rights division that used to be strong. We are DOJ access. We are civil rights on our every single individual defendants. So I want to thank you for listening, and I really hope that we'll be the queen and kings of pretrial release reform in our jurisdiction. NACDL has made a commitment to making sure that this is one of the most important things that we are studying. So if you have any, if you're in a state that's in the midst of reform or you want to talk to, you know, Bonnie Hoffman is an amazing resource, Rick Jones, Norman Reamer, I thank you for your time this morning.